Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson 21 of the platform-specific series of my 6502 assembly programming tutorials. Now, we've been looking at various systems over the last couple of weeks, and we've come to the NES this week. We're going to look at how to set pallet definitions. If you're not familiar with these tutorials, we use a common format in these tutorials. We use one nibble per channel. The first nibble is unused. We have a green, red, and a blue nibble defining our colour. So this is a single word that we pass over to our function, and a function will set the colour for us. Now, when it comes to the NES doesn't really have a palette that works very well with that kind of colour channel definitions. You see, the NES uses a NTSC palette, and it's my understanding this is essentially a sort of artifact of the colour hardware of the TV signal. And the way it works is we select our colour from this kind of rainbow wheel here, and then we select a brightness, and that combination together will make a colour. However, the colours don't really map very well to a more conventional red, green, blue. You can see we've not really got a very bright red here, and you know, well, while we've got various blues, again, we don't have a very strong blue. So what we're going to do in these tutorials today is, like on the other systems where we've had limited palettes, is we're going to use a lookup table, and we're going to use a 3x3x3 table to convert a red, green, blue value into the most appropriate color from the NES palette. Now, you can see here that the NES palette uses two nibbles itself. The low nibble is the color number and the high nibble is the brightness. And so when it comes to the NES colors, we're going to convert them in this way here. Now, obviously, if you are looking to do something different, you may not agree with my color choices here, but of course you're welcome to change the lookup table or just skip it altogether and go direct to the hardware, because we're going to learn how to go direct to the hardware. But for the purpose of these tutorials, we do need to know how to convert things, because as I say, the intention is that the code is common. Let's see that code now and let's have a look at it working. And so here's our Chibico character, and you can see, as usual, the clothing is a kind of cyan. It's maybe a bit less bright than usual. The hair is purple, but it does look quite a bit darker than it usually does. But as I say, generally speaking, it looks pretty good. And this was enough to allow me to get grime working very nicely on all of the systems without reprogramming the palette over and over again. So how do the palette definitions work on the NES? Well, they're part of the video memory, and the palette definitions are from the range 3F00 to 3F1F with 1 byte per colour. Now, the colours work in the following format. There is a common background colour, and then there are 4 palettes of 3 colours each. So colour 0 is common to all of the background palettes. We then have the sprite palettes, where colour 0 is actually transparent. So again, these are 3 bytes each. So effectively, we have our common background here, and then we have 3 colours per palette for all of the background palettes, and then all of the sprite palettes. Of course, once we've defined our palettes, we then have to define them for the tiles. This is where a rather major limitation of the NES comes in. Although the tiles on the NES are 8x8 pixels, which is very common, what's very unusual is that the NES only allows us to define the colours by default at the 16x16 tile size. Now, 1 byte will define 4 sets of these 16x16 blocks, so effectively 1 byte within what's known as the attribute table will define 4 of these tile groups, and each of those tile groups will have 4 tiles in it. Now, if you imagine that byte as being here, then these 4 tiles here will be defined by these 2 bits here, these 4 tiles here will be defined by these bits here, these 4 tiles by these, and so on. So, as I say, 16 tiles in a 2x2 grid are defined by a pair of bits within the byte of that attribute table. Now, the attribute table itself is at the end of the name table. The name table is the tile map itself. So the default tile map at hexadecimal 2000, the actual tile selection goes from hexadecimal 2000 to 23BF, and then the attribute table immediately follows and goes up to 23FF. Now, on the NES, it's possible to have 4 tile maps, name tables, and 4 attribute tables, but by default, you can only have 2 because of the memory limitations of the system. There is the ability to add upgrades to the cartridges, but by default, you can't do that. Now, I believe in theory, it is possible to have a very upgraded cartridge that does allow you to use all of these attribute tables and to allow the definition of colours on an 8x8 tile basis rather than these 4 tiles using the same colour. That said, I've not seen any NES games do it, so I don't know if this is a theoretical thing that never really saw the light of day, but it's certainly beyond what we're using in these tutorials. Now, that said, the bitmap test example we just saw and the grind program actually only used four colors for the entire screen. So this isn't something I had to worry about in my programming. But if it was something you were going to worry about, I think the important solution that you should consider is just simply doing everything in 16 by 16 pixel squares, which if you look at like a game like Super Mario and most of the very common ones, everything's designed around 16 by 16 squares. So things like the question mark blocks, those are four patterns of 8 by 8 each, so they're all the same color. And things like the clouds and things, they were always multiples of 16 by 16. And that meant that you could have easily a single color for that block, and then you wouldn't have to worry about this problem of different blocks overlapping each other and having to share the same colors. Anyway, that's the theory out the way. How are we actually going to define our colors? Well, you can see here we've got a palette definition here, and we've got our definition in one nibble per channel, green, red, blue here. So this is the background, black. This is purple here, with a bit of blue and a bit of red. And then you've got the cyan here, and then the white here. And we've got more definitions and some extra ones for the sprites, which for later tests we're going to look at. Now, when we want to actually use these, we'll just run the code here. Now, we're loading them into a temporary zero page entry ZDE, and then we're reading in 2 bytes from that entry and storing them in ZHL, zero page entries. We then call set pallet with the accumulator set to a number, so 0 being the background, 1, 2, 3 being colors 1, 2, 3, and so on. And that function will actually do the work. And here it is. So how do we actually set the color? Well, what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to read in from a lookup table. And here's that lookup table, which is the numeric representation of what we saw just here. So this is the lookup table just here. And effectively what we need to do is we need to multiply red by 3, green by 9, and then add blue. And that will give us the offset from the palette map that we need to use. And that's exactly what we're doing here. So we're extracting out the red component with this palette convert function here. What this does is it uses some ranges and it will convert to either 0, 1 or 2 depending on the color value from 0 to 15. And that allows us to split out each of those channels, and we store those temporarily in ZB, ZL and ZH. And what we then do is we multiply these up. Now, of course, when we're working with the high nibble of the red component or the low nibble of the blue or the green component, we use a slightly different version. And there is a swap nibbles function just here, which is a common function I use that just swaps all the bits around. And that allows us to use the same comparison, whether we're looking at the top or bottom nibble. Now, once we've got those components, we need to multiply the green by 9. So what we do is we've currently got the green component in ZH here. We then rotate it to the left 3 times. This effectively multiplies it by 8. We then add ZH again, and that has effectively multiplied it by 9. We now need to multiply the red component by 3. So we just add the ZB component here, which was storing the red just here. And that's effectively done that. And then we just add the blue component, which is now in ZL. We just do that once. That now gives us the offset, and we store that in the Y register just here. Now we load our palette map address and we store that in ZHL, and that is now ready for us to actually get the color that we need later on. Now, as with most things on the NES, we can only write to video memory during VBlank. So we've got 2 options here. We can either use the wait frame command to wait for VBlank, but in this case, I'm actually disabling the screen, turning the screen off. Now, I'm assuming you're only going to set your colors at the start of the game. And if that's the case, then turning the screen off makes more sense, because waiting for VBlank will actually slow things down and stop the game loading as fast. So just depending on what you're trying to do, you may want to actually change that to a wait frame rather than disable screen. Now we need to select the address of the color we want to change. Now, as I said before, the colors are from 3F00 and each definition is just a single byte. So we set the top byte of the address we want to write to 3F, and then we load in AS, which was the color selection at the start, and we store that to 2006 as well. Now, when we write a value to 2007, we are actually selecting the new color. We're writing that into the video memory. So we load in from ZHL, which points to our palette map now, and we use the Y as an offset, which we defined just here, based on that offset that we calculated. This reads in the correct color from here and sends it to the video memory. Finally, we need to reset the scroll position, because that gets messed up whenever we write to the video memory. So that then positions the tilemap back in the correct position. And then we turn the screen back on. And that's all it is to it, relatively speaking. A bit more complex than some of the systems, but still not too bad. This allows us to set the colours quite nicely. Now, as I've already said, if you wanted to use a much more flexible palette, you would actually want to do this directly rather than using my function, because you've got far more colours here in the possible palette than I've used in my lookup table. But as I've said before, a lot of what I'm trying to do here is write games for lots of systems and not just for one system. So there are compromises that have to be made there. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.